So we're still talking about DNA, and today we're going to talk about a few of the important activities DNA uses in our lives, the important things. So I have two questions for you on this picture. Number one, what is it?
Alligator.
It's an alligator, but what? Tell me more about it.
It's an
albino alligator. Question number two, tell me what?
It has no pigment in it,
color,
skin.
Okay, great answer. What could cause that?
A birthing disorder.
It's not going to be a birthing disorder. It's going to have that condition while it's hatched. What did you say?
I said
DNA. DNA, excellent, which is kind of obvious since that's what the lesson is on, that's what you're talking about. But can you be more specific? Can you think of any of the DNA processes or anything that would happen that could cause this guy to not have any pigment in his skin?
The codons don't line up.
That's a great answer. Can you say that again?
The codons don't line up.
Exactly. So what would that be called if they don't line up?
Reading. Yeah. Reading.
So basically, there was some kind of error, right? What's a genetic error called?
Genetic mutation.
Very good. So I have a quick activity for us on DNA building, and then later we're gonna build off of that. So let me get you guys set up with our handy dandy thingy. So you guys are going to be building full strands of DNA. You guys have learned about adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine, correct?
Yep.
Great. So we're going to go ahead and start building these. So put one on each side.
Take one as a pair.
Also, can you guys work in pairs?
Yes.
Is that okay?
Yes.
So y'all can either use different plates or you can, however y'all want to do it. So using what you guys already know about DNA, make sure your base pairs line up and construct how you think DNA looks.
Can you have background in your book that I'm sure can help you?
Yes.
I've washed my hands before this.
You guys do that. Yeah, y'all come and get two ropes each, and y'all are welcome to eat it afterwards, but please wait until we are finished with our DNA.
Here, go ahead
and
do it. I got
Does
it matter what color?
Oh, that one
has a good.
Let me go ahead and pass them out so everyone can get it.
It takes enough to read the slide.
Are you guys sharing?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
We're gonna do the stuff on Monday.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and get started. So, you guys know what DNA looks like. So sticks are gonna be your backbone.
Yes.
And then the toothpicks are gonna connect the gummy bears and base pairs.
My gingerbread man self would want to climb this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where are you? It's beautiful.
So, you have this structure. What shape does that structure have?
Huh? This one?
It's not a helix. Yeah, how do you make it a helix?
It's twisted.
Exactly. Isn't that beautiful?
Oh, gorgeous.
You should display this at a museum.
Oh, yeah.
Hold on.
So
oh, it's day two.
this is our model DNA. So after we finish with this, we're gonna get into some more in-depth stuff about what that DNA does and what it does. Show me the shape. Everybody's looks great. Y'all can go ahead and snack on this. We're gonna expound on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, y'all can go ahead and snack on it. We're gonna expound on it a bit, and I'll show you one that I made. But we're gonna move on. So the slides are kind of wordy. So like, there's kind of a lot of words in the slides. But if you look at the heading, it follows along with the headings in your book. And the important things that are there, you can pretty much just underline in your book if you're following along. So you don't have to worry about writing down word for word. Everything is already in your book, so you'll be able to underline or highlight that. So we'll go ahead and get into the lesson. All right, what we're talking about today is known as the central dogma of molecular biology. So this is like the basis of molecular biology, and therefore kind of how we understand the way life happens and the way genetics happen. So the flow of biological information from DNA to RNA and then from RNA to protein is known as the central dogma of molecular biology. Has everybody found where we are in the book? Is everybody there? Got that heading? Great. So first, the process by which DNA makes a copy of itself is called replication. Each one of your cells has to divide in order for you to grow and have a maintenance upkeep. So like for growth, like when you're growing, but also your body has to replicate cells for maintenance purposes as well. So DNA has to replicate itself. It has to make two of itself. It can't give its daughter cell half of itself because then it won't be complete. So that's the first point. Next, through transcription, your cells are going to copy this information that's contained in DNA into these mRNA molecules. This stands for messenger RNA. So when your cell gets ready to make proteins and do work inside the cell, it has to take copies of sections of the cell to make those specific proteins. So that process is called transcription. We'll get into it in a minute. And then thirdly, these mRNA molecules provide the information to make proteins through translation. So translation is the mode through which proteins are actually made. Does anybody remember the organelle where they're made?
Where
proteins are made?
Ribosomes.
Very good. You guys just learned that and did your project on it, right? Awesome. Can I move on? Y'all ready? Change slide. First, we have our lovely DNA replication. This one should be pretty simple. You've probably heard of it or talked about it before. But before a cell is able to divide, so y'all know that when two cells are made, it's one cell splitting in half, right? Before it can do that, it has to make a copy of its DNA for the second cell to have. And that's called replication. So to copy a DNA molecule, the cell must first unwind and unzip the DNA so that it consists of two different strands. So when you get ready to eat your candy, you had to unwind it, and you had to basically unzip it. Because there, people think of it as like a zipper. You know, like a zipper has like interlocking parts. They're not exactly interlocking, they're more like pairs. But still, it's the same process. It's going to be unzipped from one direction to the other. The enzyme DNA polymerase then attaches individual nucleotides to each strand of the DNA molecule, forming new complementary strands. So let me show you what I have here. It got a little chunky in the bottom, but essentially this is kind of our model for how this happens. So this is the original DNA strand. This is what we started with at the very top. Next, our enzyme DNA polymerase comes along. Well, a different enzyme like undoes it, but after it gets undone, DNA polymerase would be right here, and it would add new base pairs and a new backbone. So this is going to form, if it kept on going, it would form a whole new strand of DNA. Same goes on this side. So through this process of replication, we go from having one strand to having two strands. And remember, adenine always pairs with thymine, guanine always pairs with cytosine. Good? Everybody got that?
Here's just a diagram of that. So it's pretty much what we just showed you, but here's a more official looking diagram just to show you. We've got our double helix DNA with corresponding base pairs. This is the replication fork. This enzyme, y'all know that if a word ends in A-S-E, that means it's an enzyme. Have y'all learned that? Okay, well that's a common theme in biology. Maybe not 100% of them, but most of the time if a word ends in A-S-E, it is an enzyme, so it's going to like initiate something or start something. It's the biological catalyst, right? So once this happens, we have DNA polymerase. The word polymer, y'all know what that means? Poly means many, so polymerase basically means we're gonna like make many. So it like puts things together. So that's what this DNA polymerase is doing. It is taking the original strands and it's adding the complementary base pairs to make whole new strands, which is what I showed you the model of. So that's the easy one, right? Still a little bit more on replication. So during the replication, the new DNA molecules are checked for errors by proofreading enzymes that look for mismatched or damaged base pairs. So think back to that picture of the alligator. Can y'all see where maybe an issue in DNA replication could have caused that? Because if there's an issue in DNA replication, there's going to be an issue in translation. And then transcription and then translation, which makes the proteins. So if there's an issue in the original DNA, when those cells get ready to make those proteins may have issues, right? So maybe that alligator didn't have the ability to make pigments. Well, that's gonna stem from this process right here. Replication is always gonna result in two identical DNA molecules where there had only been one. So that's your key with replication. It's pretty simple, kinda easy to remember. But each new DNA molecule consists of one strand from the original and one newly constructed strand, which we just kind of explained. And because DNA polymerase cannot replicate the last several base pairs of a chromosome, DNA has special sequences called telomeres on its ends. And a small part of the telomere is used during each replication. So you can imagine that is like you have a... Let's say this is the backbone of a piece of DNA. After each replication, a little piece of this telomere gets gone. And another replication, another little piece of this telomere gets gone. And eventually, when all the telomere is gone and those base pairs aren't protected anymore by that extra piece at the end of the strand, that cell may die through the process of apoptosis. Now, there are special cells in your body that have mechanisms to prevent this from happening, but I've heard, I should have done more research before, but I've heard that people do a lot of research on telomeres because they think if you can find a way to extend the telomere or keep it from degrading, you can keep people from aging, or like you can extend people's lives because of that. So that's something really cool. Maybe we could look into it later. Everybody got these notes? Next, we have our lovely DNA transcription. So, when a new protein is needed in the cell, the DNA coding for that protein is copied into a messenger RNA. And this mRNA molecule is produced by transcription in the nucleus, then is shipped to the cytoplasm, where it's used by the ribosomes as a template to make a protein. Carefully ordered process. So, I'm going to do a lovely drawing for you guys. I'm really not that great at drawings, but hopefully this will turn out okay. So we have our strand of DNA. We're going to have a little opening here. So this one is intact. It has been untwisted, so it's straight. However, it has been pried apart by an enzyme. And of course, your DNA contains all the information your body needs. So let's say your body needs to make a specific protein, and the instructions to make that protein are going to be in this section of the DNA molecule. So your body will then make, your cells will then make a copy of this section and move it over here, and it's just a single-stranded. It's RNA, right? RNA can be double, single-stranded or double-stranded. So this is going to be our mRNA. This is going to be, what does the M stand for again?
Messenger.
Messenger, right. So this is our messenger RNA. So this messenger RNA is going to make the template for translation when we actually make the proteins. But we're not there yet. We're still talking about transcription. So like I said, the cell transcription machinery locates that segment of DNA that contains the information that's needed for that desired protein. This segment of the DNA molecule is untwisted and unzipped, allowing an RNA of the gene to be made by RNA polymerase. So if you're in college, we would draw this out a lot, like so many times. It was annoying. But we usually denote an enzyme as like something like this. So RNA polymerase is what is going to put this together. Like we said, polymer means many, ACE denotes enzyme, so it's putting many things together. So it's building this thing. But after the segment's copied, the DNA, so this part will be taken over there, the rest of it's put back together. And since we're talking about RNA, we're going to have uracil instead of thymine. Does everybody understand that DNA has adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine, and then RNA is just replaced with uracil? Have you heard that before? Great. So it's the same base pairing, except we're going to swap out for uracil. So here comes the fun part. So DNA replication happens in your cells like kind of continuously depending on what kind of cell. So that's when DNA needs to replicate itself to make a new cell. Transcription and translation are when they need to make a protein in your cell. So after they take that segment of the DNA that the protein is going to be made of, we call that mRNA. And then through the process of translation in your ribosome, that turns these into an actual protein. It's going to be functional for your cell. Now this is like the fun part. It's a little bit confusing at first, so we're going to walk through it, and then we'll do like an activity to help you guys understand it better. But essentially, a sequence of nucleotides in the mRNA can be translated into a sequence of amino acids. So these are your nucleotides. It's like a sequence of these you can look at these and determine what amino acid they're going to code for. So the information is coded in the mRNA in the form of codons, which is a consecutive sequence of three nucleotides in the mRNA that codes for a specific protein. So these are our three nucleotides. So if you don't mind, go to page 496 in your books. So now we have adenine, uracil, guanine, and cysteine. Three of those in a row will code for each specific protein. So that chart on page 496 is showing you what base pairs are together and what proteins are together. Does everybody see that? Isn't that crazy? So it's like a code. It's like a secret code. It's really cool. But that's called your genetic code. And all the amino acids your body needs and your body uses are in that code. Your body can make some of them itself. Some of them it has to get from outside sources in your diet. But if you look, most of those code for an amino acid. There are a few of them that are actually start and stop codons. So the AUG codon indicates the beginning of a protein. So if you have AUG together, that basically says, all right, this is the start of the codons that are going to make up this protein. If you have UAA, UAG, or UGA together, this essentially says, okay, you can stop now. This is everything we need to make that specific protein. Does that make sense? Everybody got these notes? Now, let's decode. I have a secret message for you guys. Did you guys understand how if you have three base pairs in a row, you can look at the letter of it and see what protein it codes for? Well, essentially here, it's kind of the same, except these codons are going to code for a letter. I find that it's kind of easiest if you write them all down and then use the chart to go one by one. But if you doing the same thing as page 497. Do you see that blue line on the page 497? See that? The AUG, AAA, AGA. That's the same thing we're doing, except instead of ascribing it to a protein, we're ascribing it to a letter. So, in the same way that amino acids make up proteins, and you can find the codes for these amino acids in these codons, we're finding the letters that make up words. So the letters make up words the same way your amino acids make up proteins. puzzles like this are really fun. Do y'all think it's fun too?
Mm-hmm. We tried unzipping this, but it
didn't. Yeah, you need helicase, that enzyme that does it for you, right?
Mm-hmm. That should be a mine looks good.
Yes.
Yes. It sizzles.
Mine looks better though.
Is that mint?
I don't know.
It's just more twisty.
Marking pitch, will your DNA strand not unzip? We got a fix for you.
Because we have friends that you want to
our robot.
So I'll keep working, I'm gonna pass out some note cards. So there are some of these I found on the internet that were like, I already done for you, but like I didn't like the phrases, or like one of them was the name of a song I never heard, so I made this one on my own, and sometimes like letters and numbers like just absolutely mix me up. I don't know if maybe I have like a touch of dyslexia or what, but I always double triple check myself when I'm dealing with this. So I did this thing like 3 times between last night and this morning. I bet we don't have a mistake. Is everybody got it? Okay, give me a few minutes. You guys did it faster than I did, though. I was a little slow. Yeah, let's go ahead and go to the answer. Who wants to say it?
It's not rocket science.
Yeah, so good job, guys. This is the way decoding works. And I have one little last thing to close. So, you know, I gave you all a note card. If you don't mind, you don't have to put your name on it. Darn, I forgot about this one. Now, I'm sorry, guys. I got ahead of myself. Can you see how maybe an issue in your genetic code could cause this? What process does it start with? What's the first thing we talked about?
Replication.
DNA replication. And if DNA replication is wrong, then our mRNA is going to be incorrect, which is going to lead to an incorrect protein. And if maybe his cells were not capable of producing those pigments. There are other genetic mutations that you can have that I'm sure a lot of you have heard of. We're not going to get into those today. I think I'll cover that later. So now, in closing, just, if you don't mind, take your note card and answer these. So we just talked about these two things. So number one, what's the difference between transcription and translation? Just give me like, I don't know, a sentence or two basically describing the difference. And the next one, write the codon for the following. So that should be on page, is it 497?
496.
The chart on page 496. So what we did, the coding, find those amino acids and write down the codons for it. And then next, just in case anything was unclear or if there's anything I could have done better, if you have any questions, please write that down too. Does anyone have any questions they want to ask? Yes.
Is it ever possible for like the adenine and the thymine to not be paired?
Except for uracil,
yes.
If they're never been together, if adenine and thymine aren't together, then most of the time your body has special like enzymes that will find it, that they're not together. So if they're not together, it's a mistake, right? So if they're not together, your body will usually find that mistake and fix it. If your body does not find that mistake and fix it, that could be a genetic mutation.
So like, what could it lead to?
It could lead to albinism, like in our example. There are different disorders, so like different, like trisomy 13, Down syndrome, that's an error like this, correct? Yeah. It could mean, I had a friend in high school who had like a form of albinism, but she had like patches of white on her skin. She had like patches of white hair. Sometimes it will be like something physical that you can see. A lot of times it could be something that's like inside your body. Sometimes it's not really noticeable and sometimes it is. It kind of depends on how much of your gene is affected and what its particular job is in your body.